Okay, Alexander, let's talk about Angela Merkel's farewell tour. And she was in Moscow last week. She was in Ukraine a couple days ago. She met with Putin. She met with Zelensky. Ukraine is just Zelensky, not even Ukraine. Zelensky's just, I think he's losing his mind. He has this Crimea conference and he's begging the international community to take on Russia, like literally take them on militarily and get them out of Crimea. And Germany's not paying attention. Not even the United States is paying attention, to be honest. They're sending very low-level diplomats. He's asking for Merkel to help out with the energy stuff and the pipelines and weapons and all these things. And Merkel's just kind of, she's just kind of floating around these various stops, saying her goodbyes and not paying much attention. The one thing that she did do with Vladimir Putin is just kind of, tell Putin, look, you're the only person that can fix up Afghanistan. Just fix it up. That was pretty much her message because she was like, we can't do anything at this point. Anyway, it's an interesting dynamic to see Merkel visit all these world leaders and say her goodbyes.
Yeah, I mean, let's be absolutely clear. Ukraine is Merkel's biggest foreign policy mess. I mean, she's messed up badly within Europe. We've talked about this many times. She's created a crisis in the euro system, which is never going to go away. It's going to get worse and worse. In fact, she's created the whole structure of the euro. She's built the European Union in a particular way that it's almost going to be impossible to unravel. She authored the migrant crisis in 2015, with which we still have echoes to this day. And of course, she's allowed situation in Germany to stagnate. And what we're now seeing in the German election is that the German electorate can't make up its mind which party it's going to back because they are unimpressed by all of them because Merkel has created a political desert in Germany itself. So lots of problems, the legacies of Merkel's leadership. But of course, if you're talking about foreign policy, the big crisis that she owns is Ukraine. It was Merkel, more than anyone else, who was responsible for the mess that we saw in 2014. It was she who insisted that Ukraine, or I mean, she didn't do it directly, but she got all her intermediaries to do it. Ukraine signed this association agreement with the EU and basically break its connections with Russia. It was Merkel who then told the Russians in 2015, if you negotiate with the new government, we'll make sure that there isn't a war in Ukraine. And of course, there was a war. It's she who then negotiated the Minsk agreements with the Russians in a meeting, not so secret meeting, in a meeting she had with Putin in Moscow. And of course, she's gone completely back on all the promises she made there. So this debacle in Ukraine is her creation. She owns it. But at the same time, as she's such a disastrous figure, you also see Merkel going on this trip. And once again, she plays, and she does this extremely well, this poker face. So she meets up with Putin, and the two talk, and they come across as the best of friends. She calls him Vladimir, he calls her Angela. I mean, they actually did, they call themselves on first names in public in that kind of way. They give the impression that there's all sweetness and light between them. In reality, and in fact, it's known that in private, they detest each other. But in public, they're very skilled at putting on this show. But let's be very clear about this. The Russians are getting all they wanted. They wanted Nord Stream 2 built. Wasn't their idea. It's Merkel talked them into it back in 2015. They've got it built. It's been built. The German business community wants it. It's a done thing now. The situation in Ukraine, I think they've long since decided that Merkel is never really going to help them sort that out. So she goes along to Ukraine. Finds the Ukrainians up in arms about Nord Stream 2. They feel deeply betrayed about it. So what does she do? She tells them, yes, I think that, gas transit from Russia should continue after 2024. Putin is already now starting to cast doubt on that. Merkel says to the Ukrainians, I can't guarantee it. And then she goes on to say to the Ukrainians, well, you've got to accept that sooner or later, for all kinds of reasons, gas transit from Russia is going to stop. She actually says that to them. She makes out that it's all going to be climate issues, but the Ukrainians are not fools. They can work out, they can decipher what she's saying to them about that. So she is going to make them extremely angry. And all those great promises of economic aid, all those slush funds and bribes that we saw being agreed with Biden just a few weeks ago. Well, we already see that all those promises from Merkel are empty air. So she doesn't, she is dishonest and manipulative with Russians. She's dishonest and manipulative with the Ukrainians. The Russians are a big country. They can absorb it. The Ukrainians are now up the creek without a paddle.
Yeah, the Ukrainians are in a really bad position, and that explains why Zelensky is also reeling from this. Yeah, I think he can't gather his senses as to what's going on, how bad things are. 80% of their GDP is the gas from last I read. Well, all the gas transit fees and everything they made from the pipeline that will go away eventually. 18%. That is going to be a huge, massive blow. And Merkel, I remember the Minsk negotiations. She actually ran to Putin to negotiate a way out of Ukraine after the NATO forces, and there were NATO fighters there, as well as the Ukraine army, were surrounded in Debaltseve in East Ukraine. They were surrounded and they were facing just a terrible defeat. It was an imminent defeat, and Merkel called up Putin and she's like, help me get out of this. And Putin, you know, he got the Minsk agreements, which no one's adhered to. The Ukrainians just don't bother with it, and there's no pressure from Germany or the United States or France. But it must be awful for the Ukrainians right now to see 18% of their GDP about to go up in smoke, to see that the man that they were hoping would deliver them all the prosperity and all the good things, Mr. Biden is just a complete mess. After seeing what happened in Afghanistan, I'm sure they're just completely just, what the hell do we do now? Because they were pulling for Biden heavily. I mean, there were a lot of people in the United States, and we've documented some of the names that were actively working against Trump and working with the Hillary Clinton camp and the Biden camp and the Democrats. They had a lot of operatives in D.C. And they're just in a really, really bad place now, it seems. And Merkel is not, she's not going to do anything to help them. She's basically saying, I'm out. See you all later.
And, see you all later.
Yeah. I'll see you in my next position as, I don't know, Secretary General of the UN or head of the IMF or head of the WHO. I don't know.
Or chairman of the European Central Bank, which is one other possibility I've heard people talk about.
Who knows?
So who knows? But that's where she's heading. That's exactly where she's heading. She's antagonized and annoyed the Russians. But as I said, the Russians can take it. And from their point of view, in some ways, it's actually worked out fairly well for them. And if the present opinion polls are reliable, and that's very uncertain because Germany is such an unstable place at the moment politically as a result of what Merkel has achieved, they're likely to get a more friendly government in Berlin before very long. I mean, the SPD, which is the most pro-Russian party in Germany, looks as if it might actually unexpectedly come out as the bigger party, which people weren't expecting a few weeks ago, largely because Merkel's own CDU is disintegrating. But anyway, that's another story, for another day. But Ukraine has been stuffed. She led Ukraine up the garden path in 2013, 2014, and now she's brought Ukraine to the point where it's no longer an asset for the West, but a liability. And she's very cynically and ruthlessly cutting it off. And she's going to move on to her happy retirement somewhere. and the Ukrainians will be left with the consequences of what she's done. So this is Merkel. I mean, she has a Midas touch of ruin and destruction in whatever she touches. But she's a skillful politician at the same time when it comes to preserving herself. And she will go away and people will go on cooing about this wonderful, you know, honest, reliable, level-headed, excellent person, even as all the countries that she has involved herself in fall into chaos and ruin.
Yeah, I visited Ukraine before the Maidan, literally a year before the Maidan, and everyone there was just, you know, pro-Merkel, pro-EU. And, you know, everyone that I spoke to, I told them in casual conversations that don't trust Merkel. Don't trust the EU. Don't trust Merkel. She will screw you guys. No. Merkel. She's the new prototype leader of the world, of the free world, of Europe. She's going to deliver us to salaries of 5,000 euros a month, and we're all going to be driving BMWs and Mercedes-Benzes and all that stuff. I was like, take a look at Greece. She screwed us multiple times. Absolutely. And even with the pipelines, she screwed us. But it's time for Ukraine to negotiate, to sit at a table. Zelensky needs to sit at a table with Putin and bury the hatchet and save his country.
Yeah, I know he's not going to, because he's an increasingly discredited figure. I mean, he won the election 2 years ago as the candidate who was going to, you know, end the war, carry out a rapprochement with Russia. He's now proved to be, he's now become, in effect, the even more anti-Russian leader than Poroshenko was, which is an impossible state to be in. But as I said, he's Ukraine does need to change direction. And it's the only way that it can really start to piece itself together. I mean, and I think actually both opinion polls and attitudes amongst the Ukrainian elite are starting to reflect that. I think with an increasing numbers of people, the penny is starting to drop, actually. They're starting to understand that in 2013, 2014, Ukraine took a disastrous wrong turn. I'm going to say something. Now, Ukraine has not had a good or happy economic history at any time since it became independent 30 years ago. There was one period when it did seem to be doing actually quite well. And this was from about 2000 up to about the 2008 crisis. And during that period, it was economically closest to Russia. It was actually, at that time, it was achieving double-digit growth. And I'm not saying that would have been sustained indefinitely if they'd kept close to Russia. But those were the best times. The moment they started to take the pro-EU turn, first with the Orange Revolution in 2004, and then obviously with Maidan, at that point, the wheels started to come off. Now, that's something Ukrainians need to remember and need to understand. The Europeans ultimately have no interest in Ukraine apart from a manipulative wish to use them in certain geopolitical games. The Russians potentially, well, at least while Putin is president, take a real interest in Ukraine and feel a strong connection to the country. And, you know, you should go with the person who cares about you and is predisposed to like you, as opposed to the person who wants to use you. But as you rightly said, the Ukrainians in 2014 and before just weren't listening. They didn't want to hear. And here they are.
No, it makes business sense. It makes geographic sense. I mean, here you are, a Russian-speaking country, and people in Ukraine do speak Russian fluently. You have a Russian-speaking nation. On top of you, you have Russia, 150 million people, a market right there. You've already been integrated into the Russian market on every level. I mean, it just makes business sense to say, you know what? This is where we're going to export to. This is where we're going to focus our economic engine on, because geez, we have this huge country on top of us, which is a huge market for us. And we already know the ins and outs. We already know everything there is to know about Russia. We've married Russians. We have mixed families. We travel there often. It's just such an easy, brain dead decision to make for the people to live a better life. Instead, they decided to go to Europe, a bankrupt, fragmented, completely lost union, which has no sense of itself, which speaks 30 different languages, 30 different cultures. What a freaking terrible decision this all was.
Oh, it was.
Comment on that, and then comment what happens to Germany now. Where does it go?
I know. Well, it was a terrible decision. I mean, you put it all very well, and I mean, I don't really have very much to say. But I mean, if you look at the big industrial leaders of Ukraine, even up to the moment when the Maidan events happened, I mean, to an alarming degree, they were still Soviet legacy companies. Places like the Yuzhny rocket factory, which could have been involved into things in Dnipropetrovsk, the shipyards in Nikolaev, the Motosich, which is this big company in Zaporozhye, which used to make turbines and aircraft engines. All of those companies are now practically at a standstill. And the Antonov company, which made aircraft, that's at a complete standstill. That's all gone. But those were, in a way, old industries. But the new industries, the IT industries, were also becoming very integrated into the Russian ones. Because, I mean, inevitably, Russia has by far the bigger pull. And if you're talking about the West, well, in the West, ultimately, you're always up against the United States and its IT companies. You're never really going to compete with that if you're Ukraine. So you start developing the links with Russia and its big IT sector, which you could have built on. It's all gone. It's all been thrown away on a fantasy of a Europe that, frankly, never existed. I mean, I've heard people describe Europe today, the sort of idea of Europe that so many people still have, as a cargo cult. A cargo cult being these cults that exist in various Pacific islands where the British passed, the British ships passed, and they left all sorts of, little bits and bobs, little statues or whatever it is behind them, pieces of helicopter or an aeroplane, and people started to worship them as, the expressions of the great imperial, wonderful divine power far away. And that's almost the way far too many Ukrainians became focused on the European Union and what it stood for. And as I said, it's an illusion. It's a fantasy. What you need to do in business and in the real world is you need to look at your realities, you need to look at your assets and to make the most of them. Business, by the way, taking an economic and commercial approach is always a good way, because nothing talks so realistically as money. If it is in your financial interest, your economic interest, to work with a particular partner, nearly always it's in your geopolitical interest to do so as well. So that's all I'm going to say about Ukraine. I think you put it very well. I'm just adding a few little details. I'm not going to say more. Where Germany goes is a massive question, because Merkel has created a desert. Her CDU-CSU bloc, they're apparently now polling at around 20, 23, 22%. Her anointed successor, Armin Laschet, has proved a complete flop. Most Germans are not, just can't imagine him as chancellor. So, I mean, it's like this big balloon where you can see the air is going out, basically. The Greens have flopped also. I mean, it was all expected that they were going to make the big breakthrough. Their leadership has proved completely incompetent, completely unable to run elections. They are extremely unpopular with many Germans. And of course, they took this disastrous decision to oppose Nord Stream 2, which 70% of Germans back, 75% of Germans back, and 70% of Green Party voters back too. So that was a Terrible mistake. Also, of course, the Greens, they want even more EU integration, and they want to open up Germany to massive migrant flows from all over the world. So that's incredibly unpopular also. So by default, at the centre, what you're starting to see is some movement back to the SPD, the Social Democratic Party of Germany. It's polling around 20%. It's an exhausted party. Its leader is looking a little bit more personable than Armin Laschet and the Greens. So he's just about holding it together. And of course, on the right and the left, there's the AfD on the right and Die Linke on the left, which haven't really sorted themselves out, unfortunately, and so far are not making the kind of breakthrough that Germany, in my opinion, needs. So the result is we have a centre, a Merkel centre, which is itself still there, but is disintegrating, because without her, it's losing all coherence. So the way it looks at the moment is Germany, after September, it's going to have a weak, unstable government, and it's going to drift. Merkelism is going to continue without Merkelism, without Merkel, and it's going to be drifting even further and increasingly unable to make strong decisions or important decisions of the sort that Germany desperately needs.
Yeah. Well, Merkel wasn't making good decisions either. But
no. She wasn't. You know,
she was making decisions, but just they were not.
She was making all. She was making all the wrong decisions. Now we're going to have a situation, I suspect, where nobody's going to be making any decisions. So I mean, you know, it's. I don't know which is better and which is worse, but that's where we're heading.
Okay. We'll leave it there. TheDurea.locals.com. Guys, go to TheDurea.locals.com because we've got all kinds of great content there from everybody in the community. It's really a cool resource. To be quite honest, I enjoy going to the Locals page and just grabbing all kinds of articles and information. Very cool stuff. And BitChute, Rumble, SuperU, and Odyssey, the new media platforms where you'll find all of our videos. The Duran videos, Alexander videos, my videos, all in one place. They're all on those platforms. The links are down below. And of course, the Duran shop, Alexander, 10% off. Use the code Real News.
Absolutely.
You've got the U.S.?
Yeah, I've got the U.S. mug. Yeah, absolutely. You've got Greece.
Cool. Take care, everybody.